In the last class, we have seen, we have introduced our course, Mathematics 1. We have given a brief idea of all the modules we are going to study in our Mathematics 1 syllabus. And today we are going to begin with our very first module and very familiar module, that is matrix. So this is our module 1 of Mathematics 1. And the topics which we are going to deal today will be first, what is matrix and types of matrix. Then we will be seeing determinants that you have done in class 12th, after determinant we will be learning how to find minors, cofactors, adjoint and finally inverse of a matrix. We can find inverse using two ways. One is using the formula, adjoint formula, and the other one is using elementary transformation method. This is the two ways with the help of which we can find the inverse of a matrix. Later on, we will come to sixth term of linear equation. We will be learning how to solve it and how to represent it in matrix form. Here we will have one method which is known as matrix inverse method. Then we will be learning a very new topic, that is rank of a matrix. And for finding rank of a matrix, we require how to convert matrix in its echelon form. This will be, we will see later. And finally, the last topic for today will be consistency of a system. Of a system of linear equation. So these are the topics we are going to cover today. Let's see them one by one. Types of matrix. Okay. First, what is matrix? So, matrix is arrangement of numbers. It's arrangement of numbers in m rows and n columns. Horizontal lines are known as rows and vertical lines are known as columns. We represent matrix like A is equal to A of ij m cross n. Here m cross n is the order of matrix, and here A of ij are the elements of matrix, where I stands for row and j stands for column. A of ij are known as elements of matrix, or they are also known as entries of a matrix. Where do we use matrix? We use matrix. Matrix has a very big role to play in almost all the fields. We highly use matrix in probability, We use it for solving system of linear equation. We use it in quantum mechanics. We use it in computer science for data storage. And so more. Almost every field we are using matrix. Then these are the uses. This is about matrix. Now coming to the types of matrix. I will do really very quick because these are just the syllabus which we have already covered in class 12th. So I will try to cover them speedily. First types of matrix. First is raw matrix. I will explain it with examples. Raw matrix, a matrix which have one row and multiple columns. Then column matrix, a matrix which have only one column and multiple rows. Then third one, null matrix. Null matrix a matrix whose all the entries are zero is known as null matrix. For example, 0, 0, 0, 0. This is a null matrix with no elements. All the entries are 0. After null matrix, we have square matrix. A matrix where M is equal to N. That means number of rows is equal to number of columns. For example, a matrix with 2 cross 2 order, or a matrix say 4 cross 4 order where rows and columns are same. This is an example for a square matrix. Then after square matrix we have diagonal matrix. Diagonal matrix is a matrix where all the elements except the diagonal are zero. For example, this is our diagonal and all other elements except this diagonal elements are zero. This is an example for diagonal matrix. Except the diagonal. And whenever we are talking about diagonal of a matrix, it always means this right diagonal. We are never dealing with the left diagonal, and this diagonal is known as principal diagonal. This is principal diagonal. Whenever we will talk of diagonal, it is always the principal diagonal, the right diagonal. Then scalar matrix. This is also a diagonal matrix, but the diagonal elements have to be same, that they have to be identical. For example, it's 2, 2, 2, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. This is a scalar matrix. A scalar matrix is also a diagonal matrix. The only difference is in diagonal matrix, diagonal elements can be different, but in scalar matrix, diagonal elements will be same. That's the only difference between diagonal and scalar matrix. Then after scalar matrix, we have identity matrix, or which is also known as unit matrix, which is very famous and you all do know. So identity unit matrix is also a diagonal and scalar matrix, but the diagonal elements have to be particularly 1, 1, 1, 1, and all the remaining elements are 0. This is a unit matrix or identity matrix. Scalar matrix and unit matrix are also diagonal matrix. The only difference in the three are diagonal elements can be different. Diagonal elements have to be same other than one, and if the diagonal elements are one, it is particularly known as unit matrix or identity matrix. Then next we have transpose of a matrix. We have seen these all types in your previous classes. Next, we have transpose of a matrix. So, transpose of a matrix is interchanging the rows and columns. The rows will be converted into columns, and the columns will be converted into rows. So, interchanging rows and columns is known as transpose of a matrix. That means if we have any matrix, A of ij of order m cross n, then its transpose will be A of ji m cross n. I will become column here and j will become row here. This is transpose of a matrix. For example, let's take an example. If it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 0. We represent transpose of a matrix by the symbol AT, which is A transpose. So it's if this is A, then its transpose will be 1, 2, 3. First row is converted into its column. So this first row, first column. Second row, it will be the second column. That means it will be 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 0. This is transpose of a matrix. I hope it's clear. After transpose of a matrix, what more we have? Some properties are there of transpose of a matrix. You must be knowing A transpose, ka whole transpose will give you again A. If you double transpose of matrix, you will get the original matrix only. Then we have, after transpose of a matrix, we have symmetric matrix and skew symmetric matrix. Symmetric and skew symmetric. Symmetric matrix, if A transpose is equal to A, then it is symmetric. And skew symmetric, if A transpose is equal to minus of A. That means if transpose of any matrix gives you back the original matrix, then it is known as symmetric matrix. And if transpose of any matrix give you the negative of that matrix, then it is skew symmetric matrix. Example we can take for both. For symmetric, let's take any matrix, say it's 3, 2, 0, 2, 1, 9, 0, 9, and say 7. Let's find its transpose. If I find its transpose may be, row will be converted into column. That means 3, 2, 0 is 3, you can check it here itself. 3 to 0, it will be 3 to 0 only. 2, 1, 9. Sorry. 2, 1, 9, we give you back 2, 1, 9. And it will be 0, 9, 7. So we can see A and A transpose, they both are same. So we can say it is an example of symmetric matrix because A is equal to A transpose. Both the matrix are same. So this is example for symmetric matrix. Then if we talk of skew symmetric, again we can take an example. Let's take an example for Q symmetric. Take any matrix. Let's say 0, 3, 2, 3, 2. Let's find it transpose. So again row will be converted into column. So 0, 3, 2 will give you 0 first row into first column, then second row into second column, that means minus 3, 2, 5, and it will be minus 2, 5, and 2. If I take minus common, it will be 0, 3, 2, minus 3, it will be minus 2, 5, and it will be minus 2, minus 5, and minus 2. Here it will be minus and minus. So we can say A transpose equal to minus of A. Therefore, the matrix is skew symmetric matrix. Then, upper diagonal and lower diagonal, triangular matrix. Next, we have triangular matrix. There are two triangular matrix, one is upper triangular and one is lower triangular. From the name itself, it is very clear. Upper triangular means the lower triangle has to be zero. That means lower triangle of a matrix has to be zero, and thereafter we will have just the upper triangular. This is example for upper triangular matrix, where the lower triangle is 0 and we have upper triangle. For lower triangular, this is upper triangular. For lower triangular, it's just the opposite. Upper triangle has to be 0. That means elements above the diagonal have to be 0, and we will have just non-zero elements below the diagonal. That means if this is our diagonal, we will have elements here and the upper triangle will be 0. This is lower triangular matrix. If we have lower triangle, it's lower triangular. If we have upper triangle, it's upper triangular. Then we have trace of a matrix. This is new for you people. Trace of matrix. Trace of a matrix means sum of diagonal elements. Sum of diagonal elements of a matrix. For example, it's 1, 3, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 9, 2, 3, 2. If we have to find the trace of this matrix, we represent trace with capital T and small r. Trace of matrix A is equal to sum of the diagonal elements. That means this is our diagonal. So it will be 1 plus 6 plus 2, which will give you 9. So this is trace of any matrix. Suppose if it is minus 2, then the trace will be, it's 1 plus 6 minus 2, it's 7 minus 2, that is 5. This is trace of any matrix. Trace of matrix means, it simply means sum of the diagonal elements. Then when do we say two matrix are equal? That is equal matrix. Suppose you have any matrix A and B. When do we say both the matrix are equal? We say two matrix will be equal if their sizes are same, size of matrix are same. Size means order. Their order has to be same. If this is M cross N, then it has to be same m cross n. Their size must be same, that is the first thing. And the second one is corresponding elements of both the matrix have to be same. That means A of ij must be equal to B of ij. Corresponding elements have to be same. If both these things satisfy, then only we say that matrix are equal. Size have to be same and corresponding elements have to be same. Then the matrix are equal matrix. Then we have orthogonal matrix. If A into A transpose gives you back identity matrix, then we say this is orthogonal matrix. This you can always prove. Then we have idempotent matrix, which is if A square is equal to A only, then we say it is idempotent matrix. And finally we have involuntary matrix, which is A square is equal to I. These three matrix, orthogonal, idempotent and involuntary, you can always prove. You just have to find the transpose, multiply and get identity matrix. Again, you square a matrix and get back A, you will get idempotent. And if you square and if you are getting identity matrix, then it is involuntary matrix. With this, we are done with the types of matrix. These are all the types of matrix which you must be familiar with. After this, coming to determinants, which is our second topic, determinants. Determinants we have seen in class 12th. Almost every one of you are familiar with determinants. We represent determinant within this brackets. If this is A11, A12, A13, A21, A22, A23, A31, A32, A33. These are the elements of the determinant. We know how to expand a determinant, how to get the value of a determinant. We expand the determinant along any row or along any column. Let's say if we expand the determinant along say R1, then the value of the determinant will be, it's A11, that is first element, delete the first column, first row, you will left with A22, A23, A32 and A33. Then second element, delete that particular column, delete that particular row in which it lies, you will be left with it's A21, A31, A23 and A33. Then the third element of that row, that is A13, deleting that column, be very attentive, we have to delete that column in which it lies, you have to delete the row in which it lies. So we are finally left with A21, A31, A22 and A32. Coming to the signs, it's always alternate sign. If this is plus, minus, plus. Solving it will give you the value of the determinant. And we do know how to solve a 2 cross 2 determinant. These all are 2 cross 2 determinant. We do know. We know it's A22 into A33 minus A32 into A23. If we take an example, if it is 2, 3, 5, 6, the value will be, it's 2 into 6, 12, minus 5 into 15, 5, 3 is 15, so it's minus 3. This is how we are solving a 2 cross 2 determinant. And solving this, multiplying with that particular element, will give you the value of the determinant. This is how we are finding the, how we are solving the determinants. which will be very useful in our matrix also. Then with determinants we come to minors and cofactors, and then adjoint followed with inverse. Let's see how to find a what are in minors and cofactors first. Usually students are very confused in minors and cofactors. Please be very attentive. Let's say any determinant. Say 1, 5, 6, 2, 1, 0, 2, 1, 1. This is any determinant A. We do know how to find the determinant, value of a determinant. Now we have to find minors of this determinant and cofactors. So, first step, expand along any, not any, we have to expand along each row. First R1, then R2, then R3. But we do not require the elements here. That means, let's take the first element. It's 1. Delete that particular column in which it lies. Delete the particular row in which it lies. If I delete this, and if I delete this, I'm left with 1, 0, 1, 1. Let me write it down here. So it is 1, 0, 1, 1. Then, coming to the second element, again delete that row in which it column which it lies. Deleting the row in which it lies, we are left with 2 0 2 1. Write it down, 2 0 2 1. Again coming to the third element, delete the particular column and deleting the particular row. Deleting this and this, we are left with 2, 1, 2, 1. It's 2, 1, 2, 1. Have we noted the difference in calculating determinant and minor? The difference is, in determinant, we have used the elements as well. 1, 5 and 6. But here we are not using the elements. We are just using finding the 2x2 matrix determinant, which is associated with that particular element. Calculating it, it's 1 into 1 minus 0, we are getting 1. It's 2 minus 0, 2. And it's 2 minus 2, it's 0. This is about the first row, R1. The same we have to do with the second and third row. And these values which we are getting, 1, 2, 0, these are known as minors. These are our minors. In the same way, let's do it the same for second and third row. Now coming to 2. Deleting this row, particular row, and column, we are left with 5, 6, 1, 1. Next, 1. Deleting this, and this we are left with 1 6 2 1. Then coming to the third, it is 0. Deleting the row, deleting the column, 1 5 2 1. Again calculating the values, it's 5 1 5 5 minus 6, it's -1. 1 minus 12, it's minus 11. And it is 1 minus 10, it's minus 9. This is what we have done with respect to the second row. Now coming to the third row. First element is 2. Along 2, delete the column, delete the row, 5, 6, 1, 0. Then along 1, deleting the row, in the column and row, we are left with 1, 6, 2, 0. And finally, for the last element, it is 1, 5, 2, 1. Again, solving it, we are getting it's minus 6, this is minus 12, and this is 1 minus 10, minus 9. So, we will just write down the values separately, that is 1, 2, 0, minus 1, minus 11, minus 9, minus 6, minus 12, and minus 9. These are our minus. This is what we call minus. So minus is expanding determinant along each row or column one by one and getting the 2×2 determinant values are known as minus. Please be very careful. We are not using the corresponding element. We are just expanding and getting that 2×2 determinants. So these values are known as minus. Coming to cofactors, if we cofactors are known as signed minors, we call cofactors as signed minors. That means if we put sign to minus, it gives us a matrix, a determinant of cofactor or matrix of cofactor. And how we are putting this sign? Let us form a matrix of this minus. We generally represent minus with M of ij. Now put sign alternatively. It's plus, minus, plus, minus. It's plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. Putting this sign, we will get a new matrix. It's plus, 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 minus plus, it's minus, it will be 0, minus minus will give you plus, plus minus will give you minus, minus minus will give you plus, plus minus will give you minus, minus minus plus, and plus minus minus. So this is our new matrix which we represent with capital Aij, which is known as the matrix of cofactors. These are our minors, and when we put sign to our minors, it becomes cofactors, and this is our cofactors. This matrix is matrix of cofactors. I hope it's clear, and the difference between minors and cofactors is clear as well. Then coming to a adjoint, which is very closely related to minors and cofactors. If I transpose this matrix of cofactors, it will give you a new matrix which is known as adjoint of matrix. For example, if I transpose this matrix, transpose we have already studied, interchanging the rows and columns. If I interchange the rows and columns here, then a new matrix will form. This is adjoint of A, which is known as adjoint of A. Usually we represent adjoint with ADJ. So transposing this will give me 1 minus 2 0 column into row into column, then 1 minus 11 9 minus 6 12 and minus 9. This matrix is known as adjoint matrix. First we are finding minors. Putting sign to minus will give you a matrix of cofactors, and after transposing matrix of cofactors, we are getting a new matrix which is known as adjoint matrix. And from here we can derive formula for inverse of a matrix, which is very important. We represent inverse with A minus 1. This is inverse. And the formula for inverse of a matrix is 1 upon determinant A into adjoint of A. We have learned how to calculate adjoint of A. We have seen how to calculate determinant, value of a determinant. Putting the values in the formula, you can calculate inverse of any matrix. This is how you are finding inverse, and this is extremely important. Coming back to inverse, I have told you in the very earlier class that we can find the inverse of any matrix using two different methods. The first one is using the adjoint formula, and the second one is using elementary transformation method. Okay, this we have seen. A inverse is equal to 1 upon determinant A into adjoint of A, and we do know now how to find the adjoint of any matrix and how to find the value of the determinant. Putting the values, we can find the inverse. But provided determinant of A is not equals to 0, we can find the inverse of any matrix only if the determinant is not 0. And before explaining this part, I will go to singular and non-singular matrix. Singular and non-singular matrix. A singular matrix is a matrix in which determinant value is 0, and non-singular is a matrix in which determinant matrix is not 0. For example, if it is cos theta minus sin theta, then sin theta and cos theta. Find the value. If I find the value, cos theta into cos theta will give me cos square theta, and sin into sin will be sin square. Minus minus will give me plus. And we do know sin square plus cos square is 1. It's not 0. It's non-zero. So this matrix is non-singular. In the same way, if I take some other example, say 3, 2, 0, 0, I'm taking matrix, or take some, it's 2 and it's 3. 3, 3, 2, 2. Okay, 3, 2, 6. 3, 2, 6. 6 minus 6 will give me 0. That means this matrix is singular. So, this is singular. Singular matrix will give me a 0 value, and non-singular matrix will give me a non-zero value. This is singular and non-singular. And here we are saying, for finding inverse of any matrix, our matrix has to be particularly non-singular. It has to be non-singular. That means determinant can never be 0. It has to be a non-zero. And it is clearly defined why value has to be non-zero. If the value of determinant is 0, our inverse will be not defined. Our inverse will be infinite. So that's why it will be 1 upon 0, which is not defined. That's why we are saying that inverse do exist only and only if the determinant is non-zero. This is a necessary and sufficient condition for inverse existence. This was our first method. Coming to the second method, which is finding inverse using elementary transformation. That you have done in class 12. I won't be going deep. You must be knowing the second method, where we write matrix and identity matrix along with. We write down our given matrix here and corresponding identity matrix. then we transform this A into I, and this will be transformed automatically into A inverse, and this we do using elementary transformation. What we have to do? We have to write matrix and identity matrix along with, then using elementary transformation we have to convert A into I and I into A inverse. I assume you remember elementary transformation. Here our identity, our aim is simply to derive I from A. And please be very particular how to derive I from A. Suppose if our A is, let's say, and we have to get I from here using elementary transformation. So what we have to do is, remember we have to get 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1. That means what our way of driving is, first we have to drag this entire column, then second column, and then the third column. This is our way which we have to follow. First we had to complete the first column, then only we have to go to the second, then we have to complete the second column, then only we have to go to the third one. It's not like first complete this, then this, then this, then no. First column, then second column, then only third column. This is what we need to do. We have to go column wise. First column, then second column. And in column, we have to be very particular. First, get this one. Here we already have this one. What if we do not have any one here? Let's say we have 7 here. If it is 7 here, first convert it into unit, element. That means first divide the entire column with 7 and get the unit element. And if it is already there, then leave it as it is. Then convert second and third element of the column as 0. That means convert 2 and 3 into 0. First get this 1, then the other two elements 0. Completed first column, then come to second column. In second column again, first get this 1. It is already 1. If it is not 1, then divide that row with that particular element, but get this 1. Then this 0 and then this 0. Then come to third column and again first 1 and then the 2 zeros. So this is our way of how we are calculating this A to I. Go column by column. In the columns, in all the columns, first get all the 1s, 1, then the zeros, 1, then the zeros, 1, then the zeros. If you use this method with elementary transformation, you can easily get the identity matrix here. If this is the method followed, you will always be very accurate in getting your A inverse. So in the second method, that is elementary transformation method, what we are doing is, first we are converting A to I, and I will automatically we will be getting inverse here. Whatever transformation we are applying on A, the same we have to use here on I. If we apply the same on I, we will get A inverse. I here and A inverse here. And this is how we are getting inverse using the second method. So, for finding inverse of any matrix, we have two methods. One is using the adjoint method and second one is using elementary transformation method. Here we are using the formula and here we are using elementary transformation, which we have done in class 12th. This is about our inverse, and please do check the existence of inverse. We have to check whether it is a singular. If it is singular matrix, then inverse does not exist, and if it is non-singular, then only we can calculate A inverse. So this is for our today's class. For the next class, we will continue with echelon form of a matrix and rank, and we will try to complete all the topics we have listed previously.